afternoon. Welcome to the final session of the 2013 Someplace Southwest Interactive Festival. My name is Hugh Forrest. I am the director of Someplace Southwest Interactive. You can always reach me at hugh@sxsw.com or Hugh by Twitter, hugh_w_forrest. That's 2 hours. Some people are for work, I'm for rest. As well as thank all the staff members who did not get the glory of coming here and announcing big name speakers. They can make this thing happen. Give a big round of applause to those people as well. A couple of announcements. We are almost done, but not completely done. Tonight is the Interactive Awards at the Hilton, right across the street on the 6th floor. The parade party starts at 6 o'clock. The award ceremony starts at 7. MC is actually Tyler. That should be a bunch of fun. And after that is the Interactive Closing Party, sponsored by Media Temple. That is at Stubbs. The talent there tonight is phenomenal, with Dead Mouse and Richie Cotton. We'll see you there. Maybe. Next week, you will get in your email box a survey about Southwest Southwest. Please, please, please take a few minutes and fill this thing out. Give us all your positive feedback, even more importantly, give us your negative feedback on what we need to improve on. Your input is what helps us continue to improve. Every year when we read the decent surveys, we learn about lots of things that happened at the event that we had no idea happened. So again, please give us as much feedback as possible. Positive feedback is great. Negative feedback is even better in terms of us making the 2014 event even better. For next year, our dates are March 7th through 11th. Registration probably open on August 1st. I mentioned that because if you register early, you have the best choice of hotels. Sometimes be an issue, so I encourage you to register then. I'll also mention that there is help on the horizon in terms of the hotel challenges in Austin. We'll have a couple of big new downtown hotels in 2015. Also, if you've gone to lots of programming during the event, you've probably had one, if not more, moments saying, that panel wasn't so great, I could do something better. If so, please take part in the process that we call Panel Picker. That process starts in June, and that is where people in the community, such as yourself, suggest programming for the 2014 event. This programming that is suggested by the Panel Picker forms the bulk of content for next year's event. We take this very, very seriously. Again, that process will open in June, close mid-July. Watch sxsw.com/interactive for more information. All right, one last time to plug in this donation stuff. We are collecting funds in 2013 for Architecture for Humanity in the Rebuild One Block effort. If you're lucky enough to see Cameron Sinclair speak on Friday, March 8th, he's great. What he's doing with Architecture for Humanity is great, and we'd like to support that. We're also supporting the Electronic Frontier Foundation, particularly in their efforts to overturn some of the draconian laws that were used to prosecute Aaron Schwartz. There's a Razoo widget on the right nav bar at www.sxsw.com/interactive. Please try to make a contribution, because we need to incentivize this and gamify this. If you make any kind of contribution, $1, $2, $3, $5, email me the receipt, you@sxsw.com by 11:59 p.m. Again, make a contribution, $1 is all it takes. Email me the receipt, you@sxsw.com. I'll put you in the drawing to do free registration for Southwest Southwest Interactive 2014. You can get that to me by 11:59 p.m. tonight. This donation effort reflects my strong belief that Southwest Southwest Interactive is about community. Community is what powers Southwest Southwest. Community is what makes the event compelling. The better we learn to listen to you, the community, the better event we become. And again, this is something that's very, very important to me. This is something I talk about a lot whenever I have an opportunity to give these little pre-keynote announcements. It's something I talk about year-round when I talk about Southwest Southwest. I know that a lot of my views of the community were shaped by Bruce Sterling. You may have heard the story, it is not urban legend, it is in fact true. In the early days of Southwest Southwest Interactive, particularly back when it was called Southwest Southwest Multimedia, Bruce would typically give the closing marks of the keynote and would bring a sheet of paper, would ask, is there a copy machine? He would copy 300 sheets of paper, pass this piece of paper out, and it was a map to his house and party that evening. Yes, this really happened. This is not an urban legend. Raise your hand if you ever went to a party on Cedar Street. Very good. I think Southwest Southwest became too big for Bruce's house on Cedar in about 2002. But I think the spirit and symbolism of what Bruce started 15 years ago still very, very much lives on in 2013. During this 10-day period in March, the Austin community welcomes this very creative international community to our not-so-little city. Is it a perfect match? Definitely not. There's lots of traffic. There's sometimes lots of lines. And not everyone here is as creative as we'd like them to be. Yet within this massive imperfection, there's something very, very genuine here. That provides a lot of inspiration for a lot of people once they go back to their non-Southwest Southwest lives. That said, I'm sure our 5 o'clock speaker will have a much more nuanced, more enlightened, more mind-blowingly awesome perspective on this year's event. Please welcome my friend John Lukowski, longtime Austin internet activist who will actually provide the welcome to Bruce Sterling. Come on out, John.
Hey, everybody. You know, we ought to really hear it for Hugh Forrest and his dad. Our next speaker travels the world, visits and speaks at Edge gatherings pretty much everywhere. He's been all over the globe, and he's bombarded with diverse messages, like all kinds of books and tracks, tons of email, people trying to contact him with this or that, this magazine or that. And it's always about sort of like the evolving present that we're in and the emerging future. The present and the future have learned quite a bit since he started writing science fiction. In fact, the present is science fiction. He hears from some of the best and the wildest thinkers on the planet, and he's synthesizing that stuff constantly. From all this, he brings out a really unique perspective. A free-floating wisdom, I would say, about the state of human and cyborg affairs. Of all you've seen in this year's Southwest Southwest 2013, this talk is the one you're going to be thinking about in 2014 and beyond that. Please welcome Bruce Sterling.
Really sorry to miss that, but you can't do everything. That was like an exorcism, like a ritual cleansing. So if you've ever been to one of these Sterling speeches at this event, you probably know the routine. I'm going to complain a lot. Yeah, and generally there's also some kind of weird gimmick in the speech. So, you know, let me get the gimmick out of the way by the first thing. I'm in costume. I'm in costume. This is my costume as the visionary in residence for the Center for Science and the Imagination at Arizona State University. Obviously, it's Arizona State, I'm sporting here. ASU, if you don't know, is one of the biggest schools in the American Southwest. It's about the size of UT Austin here. These sleeves are all blasted with laser cover holes because, yeah, I did messing with the hardware. These are processing bubble packing holes for you Kodak fans in the audience. That's why the patterns vary on each sleeve. I also have a Arizona polo tie figurine here. This is a 3D printed scan of Bruce Sterling. You can't actually see it, but I've had my entire body scanned at the eMERGE conference in Phoenix a couple of weeks ago. Then I drove over here to Austin right from Phoenix. Three peaceful days on the stony depths of the American Southwest. That's the theme of the speech this year. The Southwest. So I kept these laser holes in the design and fabrication workshop at Emerge 2013, and we'll get back to this adventure later, but first I want to talk about Austin as part of the Southwest, like a continuum of the Southwest, because, you know, here we are, and obviously it's the Southwest. And I am an Austinite, so I thought I'd include some of our guests in about Austin, the major city. There's always, you know, a newbie wanderer at the event who's like, why is it like this around here? It's so strange, the food, the music. Okay, well, I lived in Austin before SLI ever came to exist. So commonly, I'm like forced to do this old timer thing. Now, when people confront me about it, commonly they're anxious about the huge success of the event. It's like, oh, it's so terrible that it no longer fits in your house. Has terrible harm been done by this huge influx of aliens, you know, every year? Well, no, not really. I mean, some harm is obviously done. It's annoying with bubbles and so forth. But I can tell you about the actual harm that truly irritates Austinites, the great Austin grievance. And it's not a bunch of computer geeks at SLI. No, the city got politically gerrymandered by the Texas right. So that this city, the left-leaning capital of the state, would have next to no political influence. Austin's political enemies just split the city out very cleverly so that any Austin congressional district can stretch all the way to the Gulf of Mexico or even to Mexico. So what you got here in Austin is like a blue pond and a red sea. It's like a West Berlin. Austin is under constant cultural siege. Every Austinite knows this in their bones. They know that if they ever stop being weird, they will be Dallas in 30 days. It's not all beach collar and microbrew beer around here, okay? Now, when South by Southwest occurs, it's like that awesome scene in Lord of the Rings when the riders of Rohan appear at the gates of Minas Tirith. So, you know, Austinites are not the only people who suffer by this kind of civil Cold War situation. Raleigh is a lot like that. I've ever been to Raleigh, North Carolina. Ann Arbor is very like that. If you want to know what Austin would look like without this kind of tremendous civil Cold War pressure, Boulder, Colorado. They'd all be Buddhists here, very Zen, very yoga here, unperturbed. If you want to know what the best worst case scenario is for us, then go ahead and watch it actually conclusively lost Waco. Waco, Texas, the defeated Austin. No, Waco, Texas used to be the Athens of the Southwest. That was its name. It was an intellectual center of education, of science, art, culture, radical publishing. Yes, in Waco.
But the funding's gone right now. They just took it down. They won't conclusively. Wait, it went down with all hands. Even a lot of Othamites don't know that stark truth. It's a kind of subterranean tragedy.
Also, subterranean victories in Austin, like the document war between Austin and Houston. Yeah, like Wikipedia, I looked that up, it's amazing. So anyway, I was driving up here through the great southwestern deserts of Arizona and New Mexico. The real deal Southwest. I like it quite a lot. It always has a calm and philosophical effect on it. Very visionary, very blue horizon out there. And normally it's the part of the speech where I really start screeching in indignation. But you know, I don't have to. Because listen to these quotes from Al Gore. When Al Gore was here, what does Al Gore say? Our country is in very serious trouble. But that does not mean I am optimistic. Our democracy has been hacked. American democracy has never been perfect, but more often than not, the will of the people did drive policy. Congress today is utterly incapable of passing any reform of any significance until they get permission from special interests. Now, you know you've got problems with a guy whose party is in power. Is that mournful and upset? And then there's this other politician who drops by, this Cory Booker guy, I think on Twitter. He's getting paid to sing the hurricane victims asleep in his house. And he says, here, we're losing truth. We're losing authenticity. We're losing the soul of our politics. Okay, obviously I agree with all that, because it's true. But you know, nevertheless, I feel like these two politicians have stolen some of my best doomer riffs. Especially this guy who should have been president, but turns out to be a futurist instead. Hey, I am a futurist. I never tried to be president. So, you know, last year I was up here yelling a lot from the podium all about climate change and industry consolidation and youth unemployment and Italian politics. And they're all just as bad now. I mean, all four of those. Absolutely as bad. But why repeat myself? Somewhere up in the stony elemental deserts of the Southwest, it's clean. The weather, always bad. The desert, very matter-of-fact, about the worst-case scenario. It's just been there. I was like, this is the desert. There's no water. There's no soil. If you're stupid, you will die really fast here. It's not malicious or tricky about these realities. It's not like the desert is pretending to be a lush tropical island and then takes all your water away by stealth. There's just no water. Now, the truth is obvious in 10 seconds. So, you know, I'm in this junkyard in Arizona State to get visionary in residence. So I'm out in Arizona visiting a certain desert canyon. I always wanted to see it. Walnut Canyon National Monument. Walnut Canyon, extremely southwestern place. Happened to have a little civilization in it once, from about 1100 AD to maybe 1250 AD. The most high-tech guys in the Southwest. Now, the interesting thing about these ancient cliff dweller guys is that they were much, much more high-tech than South by Southwest. Because if you're in Austin or South by, yeah, it's pretty high-tech. But it's not absolutely the most high-tech place that anybody has ever heard of, ever. But if you're in Walnut Canyon in 1150 AD, these guys are totally amazing. They've got, like, canals, stone buildings, advanced ceramics. They are so far ahead of everybody they know. They are absolutely the smartest guys anybody has ever heard of. They're the pinnacle of human achievement. They're like the Stone Age Stanford. They're like the MIT of black and white pottery. Now, you know, of course, they're not high-tech compared to us today. However, compared to everyone around them at the time, they're just amazingly progressive. This canyon they're in, 20 miles long, 400 feet deep. I saw it. It's very scary. It's amazingly crooked and treacherous. It's full of ambush spots. If you ever try to invade that canyon, Any child of all my candy can sneak out the back way and just drop a big rock 200 feet down straight onto your head.